Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is June 10th, 2018. This is the third Sunday after Pentecost. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Our pastor is the Reverend John H. Pollock. Our organist is Greg Nolte. St. John's Outreach Store is open Monday through Friday, 9:30 to 1, closed on Thursday. The Food Pantry is open Wednesday, 9 o'clock until 10:45. Rainbow Table is every Friday, noon to 1 o'clock. Everyone is welcome.
Good morning, and welcome to our worship service this morning. Today we have the privilege of celebrating the rite of confirmation for two of our young people. So immediately after the sermon, that rite will take place. We can need that to give your correction in the bulletin. The hymn Day by Day will be sung after the reading of the gospel, not after the sermon. So I'll read the gospel and then we'll sing. And then our two confirmants will come forward to receive the rite of confirmation. We welcome our visitors. If you're in the Springfield Clark County area or looking for a new church home, we invite you to make St. John's your new church home. We begin now with the order of confession and forgiveness, which is on page 94 in the front of the red worship book you find in the pew book right in front of you. And I invite those who can do so without difficulty.
Thank you.
7 in the front of the nursery. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
the scriptures. I believed, and so I spoke. We also believe, and so we speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus will also raise us with Jesus. And you will bring us, you will also bring with you into his presence. Yes, everything is for your sake, so that grace, as it extends to more and more people, may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart, even though our outer nature is wasting away. Our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For this is a slight momentary affliction, is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure. Because we look not at what can be seen, but what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Lawrence, an African exchange student in one of our seminaries, in preaching class when it came his time to preach, chose a text which talked about the glories of heaven and what we had to look forward to in heaven. And as he began, he made the comment that, quote, I've been in the United States for several months. I've seen the great wealth that is here, the fine homes and cars and clothes. I've listened to many sermons in churches here too. But I've yet to hear one sermon about heaven, because everyone has so much in this country, no one preaches about heaven. People here don't seem to need it. In my country, most people have very little. So we preach on heaven all the time. We know how much we need in the world. Lawrence has a valid point. You watch and listen to many preachers, you never hear them talk about heaven. In fact, outside of myself, hearing myself, I can't remember the last time I heard a preacher talk about heaven. And I'm going all the way back to my high school years. From high school up to now, 4 years of seminary. I don't think I ever remember one of our professors ever giving a sermon about heaven. Instead, it seems like when we listen to preachers today, they most likely are going to speak to us about how to do this or that. How to raise your family, how to handle your finances, how to take the best advantage of social situations, or they're going to tell us how bad society is. And how all these things going on in our culture is ruining our children. We'll be lucky a generation or two from now to even have a majority of Christians in our land. The good news sure doesn't sound like good news when preached in those types of messages. But what about heaven? Today, we cannot avoid the topic of heaven, because in our second reading, that is what St. Paul is talking about. He is talking about heaven. He is talking about things we know about it. He's talking about those tenets of our faith that enable us to face each and every day. In our reading, it ended with the fifth chapter of Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, the first verse. And that is the verse of our main focus today. We will look back at some of the fourth chapter, but our main focus is this first verse of chapter 5. It begins with St. Paul saying, for we know, that's a word of confidence, we know, it's not we assume, it's not we think, it's not we feel, it's we know. The Greek word translated as know means to be sure of something, to be aware of it. It means to understand it, to perceive it, to have fullness of knowledge concerning what you're talking about. It means to see it with the eye of the mind. We all experience that, where we don't see something with our physical eyes, like now I'm looking out at you, I see you all with my eyes, but in my mind, since we're talking about heaven, my mind's eye is flashing pictures of what heaven is like from what we learn from Scripture. So St. Paul is confident. We know. We're sure. We are aware. We understand without any doubt that we have this place awaiting us, the kingdom of heaven. This place where Jesus Christ himself prepares our eternal dwelling place. Where Jesus loves us so much that he takes that time to prepare himself. As you've heard me say many times before, he doesn't pass it off to the archangels, St. Michael, St. Gabriel, St. Raphael. He doesn't pass it off to St. Peter or Paul, St. James or John, St. Andrew, Thomas, or Barnabas, or any of the rest. He prepares his place.
St. Paul is telling us we're not whistling past the graveyard. We aren't hoping against hope. We know that there is this heaven with a place for us. And how do we know? We know because of the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ. We know because Jesus willingly went to that cross, offering himself as the sacrifice, the perfect sacrifice, for the sins of the people. We know because Jesus' blood washes us pure sin. As the prophet Isaiah prophesied years and years before the coming of Jesus, though our sins be like scarlet, we become like a son. And so this is how we know. We know because Jesus sealed these promises with his death. And then on that third day was raised. And 40 days later ascended into heaven. So that we know this, we can affirm this, we affirm it. That's what Andrew and Sarah will be doing in a few minutes, affirming this faith that we know there is a heaven. How do we face another day if we didn't have a promise of heaven? How would we face a day of pain, a day of struggles, a day of disappointments, a day where we see violence all across the TV, where we see acts of inhumanity towards other human beings? How do we face a day of rising costs, death of loved ones, failures, and tragedies? We face it because of what we know. We face it because this we know, that God, through his Son Jesus Christ, has prepared a place for us. And that this life is not the end of the story. This life is just one check in the book of our life. At the beginning of chapter 4, which we did not read, St. Paul sets a tone for what he writes in the rest of that fourth chapter, in this first verse of the fifth chapter, when he tells us, by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart. By the mercy of God, we do not lose hope. That's how we face everything. That's how we get out of bed in the morning when everything seems to be going wrong. That's how we handle the disappointments and the tragedies and trials of life. Because by mercy, the mercy of God, we do not lose heart because we know God loves us and is preparing that eternal place for us. The word translated as mercy. This is chapter 4, verse 1. The word means to relieve someone's affliction. It means to alleviate their suffering, or to alleviate their distress. It means to ease someone's misery, to have pity on them, or compassion. Without Jesus Christ, we are simply sinners in the hands of an angry God, trying to earn salvation, which we will never be able to do. Because of Jesus Christ, because God sent his only Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him, we have this mercy from God, in which he relieves our affliction, alleviates our suffering and distress, where he eases our misery and has pity and compassion on us, because now, instead of a sinner in the hands of an angry God, he sees a child in the heavenly. He sees his child. We are all the children of God, called to the family of faith by the work of the Holy Spirit, calling us to the gospel and enlightening us with his gifts, sanctifying and keeping us in the true faith. The phrase not lose heart, it means to lose heart, it means to get into trouble, to be discouraged, to be exasperated by difficulty, means to be defeated in the spirit. It means to be in a state. I'm sure some of you have run into people like I have, who are not followers of Jesus Christ who are defeated in spirit, who are ejected, who have given into trouble or discouraged, because they have nothing in which to make their life alone, except themselves. They have no hope. They have nothing to affirm. And so that their life is a life is full of misery. In some cases, we have those unfortunate people who develop such an attitude like that, they think the best solution is to commit suicide and get out of this world altogether. And that's not the message of the Christian faith. Our message is that we have this hope. We have this assurance through our Lord Jesus Christ. So by God's mercy through Jesus Christ, we do not lose hope. Yes, things can be disappointing. Things can be tragic. Things can be difficult. But we don't lose heart. Because this is not the end of the story. There is more to come. As we continue to look at the first verse of chapter 5, he says, What we know is that if this tent, that is our earthly home, our earthly abode, our earthly dwelling, our earthly tent is destroyed, that means to be demolished or to disappear, to be destroyed. We have a building, a structure from God, a house not made, not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Eternal means perpetual, not limited by time. So although this earthly structure, a physical body, may be wasting away as we become older, and may be taking us further away from life on this planet, but at the same time closer to life with Jesus in eternity, we do not have to worry because we have this new home in heaven which lasts forever. So for us, death is not a problem. Sure, there's grief and death, and there's sadness, sorrow when we lose someone we love. There is someone dear to us. But we do not grieve as those who have no hope, because we know that someone is going to that place prepared for them by Jesus Christ himself. We know we have a future, an eternal existence, everything is perfect. There are no physical, no emotional, or no mental problems in the kingdom of heaven. There are no political problems or political fighting in heaven. We're free from all those things that give us stress or anxiety or worry. We don't have to worry about whether our job is going to be eliminated. We don't have to worry about if our health is going to hold up long enough for us to reach retirement and enjoy the benefits of all those years of working. In heaven, there will be none of that. It will not be a concern. We know this again because of the suffering, death, resurrection, and ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ. The religions of the world, they teach their people that they have to earn paradise, the afterlife, nirvana, whatever they want to call it. And what is interesting too is when you read the religions of the world, except for Judaism, of course, which believe this similar to us, they just don't believe in Jesus, believe in the same God, believe that there is an afterlife. But the other religions of the world, their descriptions of heaven is so much based on human based on human fantasy, like 70 versions of the way you do in heaven. That's God's gift to us. It's God's gift to us for having faith in His only Son, Jesus Christ. St. Augustine, probably the second greatest theologian in the church next to St. Paul, says, commenting on our reading for today in the fourth and the very first verse of that fifth chapter of 2 Corinthians, says, quote, "In immortal life we shall have a body, but it will no longer be a burden, since it will no longer be corroded." Our bodies, especially as they grow older, or when we're, even when we're younger, if we're afflicted with something, can be a burden. And we find ourselves as we age, as the majority of us here know, age, we can't do the things we used to do, or we may still be able to do them not as easily. But in heaven, we'll be that perfect. And as St. John tells us in that 21st chapter of the book of Revelation, when in his vision that he saw in heaven, there is no more death, no more grief, no more crying, and no more pain. It's hard for us to imagine a life without pain, a life without grief, a life without death. That is the home that awaits us. And this we know because of our Lord Jesus Christ. Heaven is real. And heaven is what motivates us to rise out of bed every morning and face another day, no matter how good or bad that day may be. Knowing that heaven awaits us motivates us to continue. There's a story I've shared with you before, shared a couple of years ago, and now I use it oftentimes at funerals, because it describes so well, taking a common human activity, describes so well what heaven means. One of the African students said that in his country they preach heaven all the time, but they need it. They need that assurance. They need that motivation to get up in the morning, because they don't have all the wealthness that we have and all the luxuries and freedom that we have here. And it's strange, but it's biblical. It's strange how certain people, the more wealthy they become, the less they can consider God or think God's important in their life. They think they're perfectly fine with their material things that disappear. But anyhow, the story is about a fellow who is a tremendous sports fan. And since so many sporting events take place when he's not at home, he records it. So then when he has time, he will sit down to watch the game, but he does something unusual. Instead of, like most of us would do, he'd sit down and turn off the game at the beginning and watch it through. He turns on the TV and the recorder and he fast forwards to the end. And he sees who won the game. If his team won, or first of all, if his team lost, he turns it off and erases the tape. But if his team won, he rewinds it, goes into the kitchen, gets a bunch of snacks, sits back down in the easy chair, and watches the entire game. And this is his explanation of why he does this. Some say this method can't be much fun, but I love it. No matter how bad things look for my team, I don't have to worry, because I know the end of the story. And that's how we are. That is what St. Paul is telling us today. That's why we did that first verse of that fifth chapter by saying, we know, we are assured, we are confident that that place in heaven is awaiting us. This is what Jesus did for us on the cross. No matter how bad things look, we don't have to worry, because we know what the story is. Those Christians who have been persecuted and executed still today in different parts of the world, they're able to suffer that persecution and that martyrdom because they know the end of the story. forgotten when we're in that glory of the kingdom of heaven. As Lawrence said to his preaching class, people need heaven. People need to hear that there is a hope. There is a reason for getting up every morning. There is a reason to trust. Because heaven is real. And this we know because of the action of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so we thank God that by faith in Jesus Christ, heaven will be ours. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Continuing the covenant God made with you in holy baptism, to live among God's
people to hear his word and share his supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people, following the example of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. The soul answered, I do, and I ask God to help me. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, who wonder in the Spirit you have made Sarah and Andrew your own. You forgave them all their sins and brought them to newness of life. Continue to strengthen them with the Holy Spirit and daily increasing in their gifts of grace, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and light, the Spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Father in heaven, Jesus said, stir up in Sarah the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm her faith, guide her life, empower her in serving, give her patience and suffering, and bring her to everlasting life. Amen. Father, in him, for Jesus' sake, stir up in Andrew the gift of your Holy Spirit. Confirm his faith, guide his life, empower him in his servant, give him patience and suffering, bring him to everlasting life.
For our offering, our ushers today are Gina Pollock and Sharon Leach.
For those who carry that difficulty, please stand. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, keep you in his light and truth and love, now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our worship with Be Thou Thy Vision, hymn number 793, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 793.
Concludes our service. Congratulations to Sarah and Andrew on their confirmation. Flowers on the chancel stands were given by Harvey and Sally Baker in honor of their grandchildren, Sarah and Andrew's confirmation. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.